Hi, welcome to this lecture. In this lecture, I'm going to take you through Azure COSMOS database and its capabilities. Azure COSMOS database is a NoSQL data store. Unlike traditional relational databases where you have a table will have a fixed number of columns and each row in the table should adhere to the schema of the table. Unlike that, in a NoSQL database, you don't define any schema at all for the table. And each item or row within the table can have different values or different schema itself. Okay. Once you've gone through the next lab, you will understand what I mean. So basically, database engine is fully schema agnostic. Since no schema and index management is required, you don't need to worry about application downtime when migrating the schemas because you are not defining any schema itself in the first place. And secondly, it is a globally distributed database. So COSMOS DB allows you to add and remove any of the Azure regions to your COSMOS account at any time with a click of button. This is particularly important when your users are geographically spread. In that case, you need to deliver the data with a very low latency for those users. So if your database is in Australia and a European user or US user trying to access the data, then there will be a lot of latency in terms of the distance. So instead of that, you just add regions for global distribution and replication. That means any Australian user added a record into the database, that record will get replicated to a replicated database within US or Europe. Okay. And COSMOS DB will make it very easy for you. And you don't need to worry about this network of data centers, replication process and all those stuff. Microsoft will take care of that. You need to worry about application logic and business process only. Okay. And the next thing is developing applications using NoSQL APIs. If you have a NoSQL data store such as Cassandra, MongoDB, and others, when you are migrating to Azure, you don't need to change the entire application to consume the new APIs. Because COSMOS DB implements NoSQL APIs for MongoDB, Cassandra, and all those stuff, you can easily migrate your existing database into COSMOS DB with minimal changes to your application. And the next big advantage of COSMOS database is industry-leading comprehensive SLAs. COSMOS DB is the first and only service to offer industry-leading comprehensive SLAs encompassing 99.999% high availability and read and write latency at a 99th percentile, guaranteed throughput and consistency. So there are a lot of things that Microsoft guarantee with COSMOS DB. It's about high availability, it guarantees latency, it guarantees throughput, and it guarantees consistency also. Because this database is globally distributed, consistency is very important, and I will discuss about it in bit more detail in the subsequent part of this lecture. And finally, look total cost of ownership. Since COSMOS DB is a fully managed service, you no longer need to manage and operate multi-data center deployments and upgrades to your database software, pay for support, licensing, or operations. You don't need to worry about it. Microsoft will take care of that. I believe COSMOS database is a very good offering from Microsoft because without this, imagine if you are a startup with users from across the world. In that case, it is extremely difficult for you to manage all these replicated databases and data centers with cloud computing and COSMOS database in Azure. You can easily implement that with the touch of a button actually. Okay. Next thing I would like to discuss about COSMOS database structure because you want to know how it is structured, how it works really. So let me take you through that. In terms of COSMOS database structure, firstly, you will create a COSMOS account. Azure COSMOS DB account is the fundamental unit of global distribution and high availability. So if you have two databases with different global replication requirements, then put it in two different COSMOS accounts. At a COSMOS account level, you can simply add and remove Azure regions to your COSMOS DB account at any time. And under that COSMOS account, you have database. You can create one or more Azure COSMOS databases under your account. A database is basically a namespace. It is a unit of management for the set of Azure COSMOS containers. Okay. And within a database, you can have a container. An Azure COSMOS container is a unit of scalability for both provision throughput and storage of items. A container can be called as collection, table, or graph based on the database type you're going with, whether it is MongoDB or any that kind of databases you want to go with. and container is the level where you can provision throughput. However, you can provision throughput at a database level also. But when you provision throughput at a database level, all the containers within the database share the resources. In case if you have containers with a different throughput requirements, then provision the throughput at a container level. Okay? And in turn, container can contain items. Item can be called as document, row, node, edge, or something else based on the type of the database you go with. When I say type of the database, it's basically type of the API you choose, whether it is MongoDB or Cassandra or something else. Based on that, this container and item will be called differently. Okay? And container also can contain store procedures, user-defined functions, and triggers. So this is how Cosmos database structure looks like. And the next thing I would like to take you through is global replication and distribution of Cosmos database. So let's go through that. In terms of global distribution and partitioning, Cosmos DB works in a different way. Unlike a traditional relational database where you have a table and all the rows in the table will sit at one physical place. However, when it comes to Cosmos DB, you will basically create logical partitions within a container. So you can have certain amount of items with a one partition key and a certain number of items with another partition key. They are called as logical partitions. And each logical partition can reside in a physical partition. So basically a container, if you treat that as a table, the rows on the table based on the partition key will be stored at different physical places, physical partitions. You can have one or two logical partitions can reside in a single physical partition. Okay, and a physical partition can be called as a replica set also, because you have a leader and you have a follower, forwarder. These are too detailed for you at this moment of time, so I haven't put that here. So remember that a container can contain millions of items, and you can divide these millions of items using partition key and make logical partitions, and each logical partition will reside in a physical partition. That's how the load of that container will be distributed across the board locally. And also the data from here, I mean the data of these logical partitions within the physical partition, will also get replicated to different regions, and those are called partition set. Okay, so you have vertically distributed across the regions and horizontally distributed to maintain high availability. Okay, I hope you understand this global distribution and partitioning. It is extremely important for you to choose a right partition key. I can't emphasize more than this. It is really, really key. Based on what you choose for partition key, your performance will depend upon it. Okay, you need to make sure you have right balance in terms of choosing the right partition key so that you can have an appropriate chunk of records in each logical partition. Okay. So now, because this particular container with items gets replicated globally, consistency is very important, isn't it? Because when an Australian user updated a record, you want to present that record to multiple people from multiple geographies. And you need to present that data consistently. So consistency is very important when it comes to global distribution and replication. So let's go through what Cosmos DB offers in this consistency area. Azure Cosmos DB approaches data consistency as a spectrum of choices instead of two extremes. So you have strong consistency and eventual consistency at the end, but there are many consistency choices along the spectrum. As you can see in the image, you can go for strong, bounded staleness, session, consistent prefix, eventual. The more consistent you want, the latency will increase because the user should see the latest committed write. It's going to wait until the commit is committed across the board. I have provided a link in the resource section of this lecture which explains about each consistency. Please go through them in detail. And one thing you need to remember is consistency level are region agnostic. So the consistency level of your Azure Cosmos account is guaranteed for all read operations, regardless of the region from which read and writes are happened, number of regions associated with your Cosmos account, whether your Cosmos account is configured with a single region or multiple write regions. So basically, Azure COSMOS DB guarantees these consistency levels. Based on what you choose, Microsoft will guarantee that consistency irrespective of whether you go for one region or multiple regions, all those stuff basically. And finally, I would like to take you through request units, because that's the cost of each operation that you do on the Azure COSMOS database. So let's go through request units. With Azure COSMOS DB, you pay for the throughput you provision and the storage you consume on an hourly basis. And the cost of all database operations is normalized by Azure COSMOS DB and is expressed in terms of request units. So request units, you can imagine like a dollar, and basically the cost of reading a 1KB item is basically $1 or one request unit basically. And all other database operations are similarly assigned a cost in terms of RUs. So if you do a read operation of a 1KB item, then you have one request unit consumed. And if you do a write operation, then you can have maybe two request units. And if you've done a complex read query on that particular COSMOS database container items, then you can consume four read units. So you consume multiple read units based on the type of the operation you do, the item size, and the consistency level you have selected, and also query patterns. It depends upon number of parameters. So you need to estimate how many read units you require based on the size of the items, kind of operations you do on top of it, and what consistency you choose. So it is extremely important for you to choose a right throughput. What I would suggest from my experience is create a COSMOS DB container and items and load, let's say, 1,000 items and do some operations on it and see how the request unit consumption is. And type of operations you do during this testing should be very similar to the type of operations in a real world scenario users do. So if you do with one user for 3-4 hours, see how many request units are consumed, and based on that, you will identify the number of concurrent users that generally use your application and the type of operations, multiply them, and estimate throughput in terms of request units. So that's what I would suggest in order to estimate accurately. Okay, so that's it for this lecture. In this lecture, I have taken you through Azure COSMOS database, its structure, and how the global replication and distribution happens, and what are all the consistency levels that you can choose. And finally, I have taken you through request units. In the next lab, I'm going to show you how to create COSMOS DB account, create a database in it, create a collection within it, and add an item into it, and go through some of the settings associated with COSMOS DB account. If you have some time, join me in the next lab.